actually drove us towards going into this space and exploring this space with chatbots. And then I'll dive a bit deeper into what we learned, and also try to do a bit of live demo, which is always a scary thing to do in these places. But, you know, if you don't risk anything, it's all a bit boring. So let's, there we go. Let's talk about Skyscanner first. Who are we? So Skyscanner is basically a meta-search company, but we are a sort of marketplace where we bring together our partners in hotels, in airlines, in online travel agents, in car hire companies, and we make all that information available for our users, for our travelers. And some numbers around, let's see, there we go, some numbers around what we do there. So we're available in more than 30 languages right now, in a lot of countries around the world. We've got more than 60 million monthly visitors, unique monthly visitors who come to our apps and our websites and use our bots. We're actually quite good at getting people to come back to us and to go to us again and again and again. And there's around 65% of people who come back to us are people who we've seen before. We like to look at sort of how much travel we facilitate, because we don't book anything directly. But if you look at the amount of travel that flows through us, last year we facilitated $11.2 billion of travel coming through us. And we keep growing year by year, it's around 40% now. We work together with 1,200, more than 1,200 partners around the world. So historically, we started back in the early 2000s when Gareth, our founder and CEO, together with Omni and Barry, was trying to book flights to go skiing, because he really liked to go skiing. And there were lots of budget travel sites out there, lots of budget airlines, but he found that he had to go to all these airlines and to all these websites separately. And it was really annoying, and he was pretty sort of annoyed by that. And so, basically the guys built an Excel sheet, stuck some Visual Basic on top of that, and built the very first version of our website. And stuff grew from there until late last year, we were acquired by the Chinese company Ctrip for roughly £1.4 billion. Just by us, they're good people in Ctrip, it's cool to work together with them. But really, all that aside, what is our ultimate goal at Skyscanner? Our ultimate goal is to make travel booking as easy as it is today to buy a book online. And let's, I guess, dive into that a bit. And let's dig into it a bit. Because if you buy a book online, if you buy a book, say, at Amazon, your choices, your inputs to that choice are fairly limited. You want, you know your author, you know the book that you want to buy. You want to buy paperback, hardback, maybe audiobook, maybe something on Kindle. Directly from Amazon or from a reseller. It's a fairly static process, and the options field is large, but not ridiculously large. Whereas if you look at travel, there's around 700 airlines in the world, there's 14,000 airports, there's thousands of providers who will sell you flights, there's lots of seat classes, there's different regulations for taxes and fees all around the world, and there's a near infinite combination of routes you can fly on certain dates. Say, if I want to fly from our office in Edinburgh to our office in Singapore, that gives me around 100 different route options, 100 different routes that I can fly. And for each route, there's dozens of providers who are willing to sell me for varying prices. So that's quite a complicated sort of space to operate in. And we're trying to build various sort of systems that work on places that are convenient for people to use them. So we're trying to work on smartwatches, we're working on Alexa, personal assistants, but also on the more traditional apps and websites, so lots of different devices to work on. Here's a number, big number, it's more than 50 million now, kind of thing. But that shows that because we were early in getting into the app economy, as it's called, we managed to rack up quite a lot of downloads and lots of stars and upvotes, and people were pretty pleased with our apps. You can see here on the screen, our apps for flights and hotels and car hire all went very well. But what we found was it's pretty hard to actually keep going with apps and to innovate in these space of apps. So consider this for instance. If you look at the app stores, at the Android and iPhone app stores and those around, there's roughly 3 million apps available. 3 million different apps. And now consider this question. How many new apps do you reckon most users download per month?
Two.
I'm hearing twos and threes and ones. And a few numbers. This is the answer. So that's a challenge. Like if you look at this, this is from a couple of years ago, but it still holds. Most people, on average, don't download any new apps ever. They just have a set of ones. There's people out there, for sure, who download every new app. Like, there's people who download everything they find interesting. There's people who will download stuff from a friend's recommendation. But if you look in general at the public, this is the US, it goes all over the world, people just don't download new apps. And apps in general are hard. So, say roughly 66% download no new apps. But retention is really hard as well. Like, people drop off during the first use, roughly 50%. People will not come back after a few days of trying. You can see that 77%, like after 3 months, a big percentage of everyone using apps will be gone and they will never open the apps again. There's lots of dead and zombie apps inside the various app stores. And that's other sort of stuff. So apps are very hard. And one of the reasons apps are hard is because they're convenient, they're in your pockets, you can just use them. But let's go to this quote from Jonathan Leibovitz. It's comfort, not convenience, is the most important thing in software. Text is an incredibly comfortable medium. And that's what bears out, I guess, in how comfortable it is to use our app. Because this is ours, we've optimized this app quite a lot. We spent a lot of time on user research and trying to optimize the way in which people can use this and the flows which people do. And you can see that clicking through to book a flight, maybe with some questions on it, is quite a difficult process. Like, there's a lot of steps to do and a lot of clicks to do and some choices to make. So what if you could just say something like this? Get me a PA flight from Berlin to Edinburgh, leaving tomorrow morning for less than 100 euros. That's your intention right there. Why can't you just ask that? Why do you have to click all these things and fill in all these little drop-down boxes and fiddle around with that stuff? So, to look at how we can do this, we created a bot. We started with one or two people. Back in April last year, when Facebook announced that they were opening up messenger bots, we expanded that to like 9 or 10 people. Cross-functional, lots of people were I've been doing stuff with UX engineers, a few product people, a few designers, and together we started building a number of bots, starting with a messenger bot, then moving out into Skype, building a skill for Alexa, and now for Cortana, and we've also worked in Japan with Line to build a bot with them to figure out how different markets behave differently. David Marcus, the guy who runs Messenger at Facebook, says it like this: I always like to rewind what people did before technology. Before the web era, we just had conversations. And you can see people have conversations right now. This is texting, SMS. It's not that yet. People are actually having conversations with their banks, with shipping companies, and other people. There's lots of examples out there of various companies who are using these sort of conversational interfaces we already have and we're used to talk to their customers. And another, I guess, little thought about the fact is that it's actually quite expensive for our users to use apps, because it's been known that like a relatively basic app can cost up to £35, roughly 48 euros in data charges, just to download and to get all the data across and to pull those APIs that make that app possible. And especially if you're in India or in some other place where data is more expensive, that can add up quite a lot. Stepping back a bit, I guess, towards the messaging idea. I like this quote from Benedict Evans from Andreessen Horowitz, who said, it used to be that all software expands until it includes messaging. But now we're moving into a world where all messaging expands until it includes software. And you can see that happening right now. Facebook Messenger is opening their platform. They've got around 900 million users worldwide. And they're expanding into allowing apps into their space, allowing bots into their space, talking, allowing people to connect and talk to companies and to brands. Microsoft is investing hugely into bots and cognitive technologies in general. There's a lot of money going into that, and they're really focusing on it. You can see the voices becoming bigger and bigger. We've got Alexa, of course, out there for a while now. Apple just came in. Google has been really active in this space. And we like to look at China as kind of, because lots of innovation is now happening in China. And we've seen examples of China before. And if you look at WeChat, for instance, China's biggest chat platform, they've got 880 monthly active users. It's more like 890 now, like a few months later. Roughly a quarter of those are registered for payments, so they actually do lots of their payments through the WeChat app, and they trust WeChat to deal with their payments. And like I said before, this is in Danish, a lot of the top used and top downloaded apps are actually messaging apps, whether you download downloads or whether you download sessions. So we're at the convergence here of comfort and of convenience. You're now able to use apps you were already using to chat with people, to use services that you're already going to use. And another nice quote to tide you over with that one. So, if apps were in the business of selling distractions, bots are going to be in the business of buying us time, making it shorter, making it smaller to do the stuff you're already going to do, being smarter about doing the stuff you're already going to do. And that throws up a lot of questions, like what is a bot and when does it become an agent, for instance? Like what's the difference between a bot you can ask stuff and give an answer, and an agent that will go and do things for you? Like you can see this in this example of the operator who will use humans, that's just people sitting on the other side of the line, to be a sort of concierge service. They'll book stuff for you. In this case, trying to book tickets to Bonnaroo, a music festival this summer. You can see there, and actually it's being planned in the future, they will book tickets for you at some point. There's rich media coming back, you get some nice images and some good links back. And it's all in all like a pleasant operation, and operator acts as an agent for you here, who will do stuff for you in the future. So you can just leave them up to it, you'll get informed later on. And that's a model you can see happening, or you can see be really useful for lots of companies, because that sort of spread out conversation, that length of conversation moved into a much longer time dimension is really interesting. But what if you could ask, you know, say if you were to ask a company, hey, is my package going to be on time? Is this thing I've ordered from you going to be on time? And you phone someone up, they'll have to go call whoever's sending that, and then ask them, and then come back. And all the time you're on hold waiting for the answer to come back, whereas you can do it via a text interface, via a message interface. It would be a lot more pleasant to use. And we tend to think in this stuff, this is sort of liberally stolen from Maslow, but there's a sort of hierarchy of messaging needs in a way, starting at simple transactional questions that you can just answer by querying an API, nothing smart about that, or just parse a sentence and give an answer. And we see that build up further and further towards evolving emotion. Now, what's a nice place to fly to in the summer? That needs a lot more information about where you are as a user, what actually is nice for you. And you start including personal information, I've seen this before in the other talks, that inclusion of personalization, that inclusion of emotion at some point. What's the way in which people are asking me about this? Is someone stuck at the airport wanting a flight right now because they missed their previous one? Or is someone looking to have some inspiration of where to go in a few weeks' time? The way in which to talk to someone, the way in which to present yourself as a bot is completely different in those cases. And we see ourselves slowly moving in, upwards into this pyramid. We're quite at the bottom right now with what we can do. So let's try a live demo, because that always goes really well. Here you go. So this is Cortana. Cortana is Microsoft's version of the sort of text interfaces and sort of speech interfaces we've got. So let's see if I can get this going. Cool. Let me switch. Yeah, it's awesome. Cool. I'll give it a go. Right, cool. There we go. Ask Skyscanner, when should I fly to Dubai? It's doing its thing, that's good. This will show how we're going to help you. So we've got a few minutes left, so I'll quickly go over what we actually learned along the way, because that's always the most interesting stuff, isn't it? Like, what did we actually learn from doing this? So one of the things we saw was that it's critical to treat bot users as if they're actually using your apps, as if they're fairly new into community. Onboarding and understanding by them, by your users are very critical. So this used to be our welcome message. We thought, well, just cram everything we can do into one message, it'll be nice. No one actually read this. We saw that no one actually, people skipped over it and just tried to ask whatever to it. So we had to change to like a smaller, more welcoming welcome message, which just shows you some stuff you can do and gives you some immediate options for people to click on. This is the messages interface. And we then started adding little tips of the day when people came back to sort of say, well, if you come back multiple times, let's then try to sell you extra functionality based on what you've tried to do before. So we keep track of what people interact or how people interact with our bots, and that's to see what extra stuff we can recommend them to do. And we've been very keen on using some of the technologies that the platforms offer us. So allowing us to show various options in a nice visual way, because Messenger or Skype or those other platforms will offer you the opportunity to make nice cards. Like this is all stolen from our apps, that's nice. The similar look and feel. This is important, make it clear when you're talking to a bot or a human. We've got a talk to a human button in most of our apps, where you can actually move on to someone in our customer relations, in our customer success team, and to chat to them. Because people will get stuck, or they'll want to ask something completely different that the bot can't answer. And rather than making the bot be able to answer any query, and falling over to a human was a good option. But we found that we had to make a really clear tone of voice, and a way of speaking, and in what the bot said, that the user will immediately see, I'm talking to a bot right now, versus I'm talking to Jen, who's on the other end of the line, answering my questions right now. So we're really careful to make it very clear. This is important as well. Like, we've been trying as a company to move towards giving simple answers to complex questions. Like, people have really complicated questions, like one question just now, when I said team to fly to Dubai. Like, those questions are really quite hard to answer if I were to ask you right now. And being able to give simple questions is probably more interesting than having a really long extended conversation with the user, because as a customer, what I'm looking for is someone to help me solve my travel problems. I'm not waiting for having a complex, really interesting maybe, but complex AI interaction. I just want my answer right there. And you can see that in the example we just saw. So another important problem we learned was don't build it and they'll come, because people won't come. Discovery is hard on these new platforms. It's hard to get people to know that you're actually there. If you give people ways to come into your bot by pushing and putting them through your existing channels, through your existing apps, through your existing stacks, and we did that by putting our bot link into, for instance, our price notification point where people ask for a cheap flight. That by putting them into the bot from that point, and then you can start talking to them via the bot. We also did it inside the bot itself, so if someone finds a cheap flight, in this case in our messenger bot, we've added a button to set price flights. And finally, expect the unexpected. People will ask lots of stuff which potentially can't answer, like this bottom question. The top we can ask, we can happily answer, but like, can I take my dog on the plane? It's not something we actually know about. can also have thick skin. People ask for everything. Like, you see people ask, I've lost my keys. You see people start to initiate conversations around where the shopping plaza is translated in humanity. And we had a lot of swearing, like a lot of swearing at the pot. We spread that a lot. And very lastly, don't forget what you're doing this for. Because you're doing this for people. Like, people are, if an interaction with the pot goes well, people are really happy. I see John Michael there. You're really, really, really happy with the way Alexa started working.